I would probably say that in all the years that CKNW's been on the air since August of 1954, you've never heard so much jazz on one station at one time. Bob Smith, I hope you're suffering tonight. You've been at the Palomar Ballroom in 1952. In the same year, one day later, I remember taking Louis Armstrong, along with a buddy of mine by the name of Bobby Hughes, out to, at this time, and Louis Armstrong, by the way, was always interested in youngsters and kids' bands. You know, every high school had their own dance band. But this is a Friday noon hour, what do we used to call them? Prep or pep meeting, something like that. It was a noon hour session in the auditorium, and I remember driving Louis and his troupe out to the school. This was Kitsilano High School.
American audio engineer John T. Mullen, with the financial help of Bing Crosby Enterprises, perfected magnetic sound recording just after World War II. This new sound recording technology revolutionized both radio and the recording industry, and helped the radio industry to pre-record many sections of program content for the first time. There would be no show to play back today if legendary local disc jockey Jack Cullen did not have the know-how and the hardware to record Louis Armstrong playing at Kitsilano High School in 1952. We have to go back a few years in 1948 when Bing Crosby arrived in Vancouver with his Bing Crosby Philco radio show Cast and Crew to record a special show at Vancouver's Forum. He hired Vancouver's King of Swing, Dal Richards, to supply a band for the benefit. The show was an experiment to show the big radio networks that pre-recorded programs produced, edited, and played back on the network later were possible.
Very obviously something we're interested in is recording as it would have been around 1952 when Louis Armstrong was recorded by Cullen. It's actually to a lacquer disc. I have an example here. Disc recording, once it went on the disc, you couldn't lift it off, erase it, record over. There's little scratches. Obviously, a recording was made, and an error was a mistake or a goof or a flub, and they had to start all over again and make the recording. This is a Magnacord. I have one in already boxed up, ready to hit the road. This is the mechanical transport unit. It's, I don't know the weight of it exactly, but it's heavy. And this is only half of the recorder. I'll put this down and show you the same machine. That machine is really this transport. So this has the tape on it. And notice, unlike some of the other machines, this has a 7-inch reel of tape. 1,200 feet runs at 7.5 inches a second is a half hour. If you actually brought in two of these machines, then you could tape an hour with no break and no reason to stop the performance just because you're changing tapes. It could also run at a higher speed by changing these pulleys for this pulley pair. And that ran at 15 inches a second. Obviously, you only get 15 minutes on a reel that size. This one is actually loaded with a tape of Jack Cullen, a program that he called Milestones. It was really music that he taped in film projection rooms, and he would clip onto the speaker and make recordings, and we'll just hear a little bit of Jack Cullen.
If you enjoy Al Jolson, you'll very much enjoy this next sequence from a picture that Al appeared in back in 1938. The film was called Rose of Washington Square, and very loosely it was the life story of Fanny Bryce. Alice Faye portrayed the Fanny Bryce role in it, and it gave Jolson a chance to sing some of his greatest tunes. And there's a special scene right here with a heckler in the theater that I know that our listeners should enjoy very much on Milestones. Listen now to Al Jolson, and incidentally, the first voice you hear belongs to William Frawley.
But look, I've never been on without.
Anyway, that's the Magnacord recorder. It's actually called a PT6, and was the mainstay of many broadcasters. It wasn't hugely expensive, but still professional caliber.
Oscar Blank was panic-stricken. Bing Crosby was in town, and had been for 3 days, and he had yet to set foot in Oscar's restaurant. The place was the home of the stars. Everybody knew that. The big names playing the Cave, the Palomar, the Orpheum, or any of the others would show up at noon for breakfast. It was a tradition, for cripe's sake. But Bing was ignoring the place, or worse yet, didn't know it existed. Bing Crosby was in town, all right, and he'd brought his entire Philco radio show with him. Marilyn Maxwell, Ray Milland, Joe Velluti, orchestra contractor, guitarist Perry Botkin, musical director John Scott Trotter, for the sod turning of the Sunset Community Center on September 22nd, 1948. Bing Crosby raised $22,000 in the funding drive by broadcast from the Vancouver Forum. Bing Crosby's Philco show became something of an entertainment landmark. With Bing's encouragement and support, it was the first radio show to record with a new technology called audio tape, replacing the large wax discs previously in use. The recorders used were then produced for public sale by the Ampex Corporation, which paved the way for recordings that could be played, wonder of wonders, in your own home.
Two school days a week, members of the Kitsilano Jazz Band have to show up at school 2 hours early for school to put in that 1 hour rehearsal time. There's not much time between the end of rehearsal and beginning of classes. So it's not necessarily an easy life being a member of a high school jazz band. But the outcome of all that was excellent performance on stage on June 7th, 2010. Fly Me to the Moon was another one that they worked out and did a fine job playing back. And that was for Jack Cullen, whose favorite entertainer was Frank Sinatra, who did it his way. And just like Frank Sinatra, Jack Cullen did it his way.
Good evening. I'd like to take the opportunity to share a little bit of Kitsilano history with everybody. This year, I was surprised to learn about a visit by a very famous jazz musician to Kitsilano Secondary during the 1950s. This historic visit was actually documented, and I would now like to, myself and the Kitsilano Jazz Band, would now like to pay tribute to that visit. First of all, I'd like to thank Kitsilano alumni Bob McNeely, who's been filming our jazz band for Shaw Cable, for providing me with all this info. And I'm just about to share some research conducted by both Bud and an excerpt from an interview with Neil Craigman as well. So during the 1950s, Kitsilano Secondary had a very active students' music committee under the sponsorship of Music Pro, which arranged entertainment such as noon hour concerts, dances, and the annual Voices of Kits contest. In December of 1951, the Students' Music Committee was successful in obtaining a visit by Louis Armstrong, his wife Lucille, and vocalist Velma Minnison. An enthusiastic, cheering audience of more than 1,000 students filled the Kitsilano High School Auditorium and overflowed into the halls.
School, I'm Giovanna Bombino, the teacher librarian here. I've been at Kitsilano for 25 years and have been in charge of the school archives for approximately 20 of those 25. And during the course of the years, that very first year when I came to Kits, we had a staff that comprised of some students that had formerly been Kits students. And they basically would tell me stories at the lunch table about all the wonderful people that had crossed our paths and had walked through the halls of Kits. And one of the stories happens to be of Louis Armstrong. And apparently, a very keen student body in the music department, there were a couple of people in that group who took it upon themselves to convince our principal at that time, was H.B. Smith, and they convinced him that if they could get Louis Armstrong, would it be okay for him to be on the stage at Kitsilano to do a jam session with the band? And Mr. Smith agreed, and the rest is history. Basically, the group was able to get Louis Armstrong to come to the school in 1951, and they did a brief performance on stage. And Louis then came back the following year with his band and played again. So we do have the legacy of Louis Armstrong here at Kitsilano Secondary.
How do you think things are compared to life for the students in 1952 and students in the year 2010?
Well, the school spirit, the Kitsilano spirit, has always lived strong and proud, and we still have a school song. We've had a song since 1923 when Ivor Parfitt, a music teacher here, composed the school song. So the school song, Hail Kitsilano, is sung every single year at either assemblies, pep rallies, and at grad as a closing ceremony tribute. And the students are really active. We have an active band program, sports programs. They're all, you know, school spirit reigns. I mean, once you're together and you have a common bond, you've got it.
Do you think that Kitsilano students know about the Louis Armstrong shows?
Well, they do now because of the tribute concert you did. I don't think they were publicized as much, but every once in a while when I get a chance and we're working on the history classes, we do get a chance to get into the classes and look at the school itself and what is happening here and what has happened. So from time to time I do bring it up, but unless they are going through the chronicles in the archives, they do not get the full story. What we've done is I've basically culled everything by decades and created file folders for the decades, and there's a special file here for general information in which there is a file about Louis Armstrong's visit. So looking through the information here, we actually have the Chronicles, which is the first place that I realized the full story of Louis Armstrong.
The Kitsilano School Band also played along with them. The school band and Louis' band took turns playing alternate numbers. Jack Cullen, who witnessed and recorded this event, refers to this concert arrangement in his tribute, specifically mentioning that Leslie Jones played piano nicely. The Kitsilano band members from that time period were Arnold Emery on lead trumpet, Jim McGinnis on trumpet, George Robinson on trombone, Eric Foster, Harry Ham McLeod on drums, Ed Golf, Don Gaylord, Jim Thomas, and of course, Leslie Jones on piano. When word got around to the other schools about the concert, students from Lord Byng, King Edward, John Oliver, McGee, and King George High came over to see Louis. This in turn created some pandemonium in the area, so speakers were put on the steps for everyone to hear. When Louis died in 1971, Jack Cullen paid tribute to Louis on CKNW that same night, and Neil Creighton recorded some of it. Jack had recorded about 45 minutes of the 1952 concert on tape.
Friday, new album, what did we call it? Prep or pep meeting, something like that. It was a 2 hour session in the auditorium, and I remember driving Louis and his troupe up to the school. This was Kitsilano High School. Louis had the most appreciative audience. It's back in the days, about 3 years before the rock and roll world began. The kids still dug such terrible names like Nat King Cole and Stan Kenton and Billy May and Pete Rugolo. They had such terrible taste in those days. They even liked Louis Armstrong. Bless them for it. Vancouver at Kitsilano High School. And by the way, it's not his own orchestra. This is how great this man was. He loved Kitsilano. He sat in that pretty good piano mechanism. Whoever played piano at that time, but this is the Kitsilano High School Band with Louis Armstrong playing trumpet and doing the vocals.
I would now like to share some of this historic recording with you all. Once again, Louis Armstrong in the Kitsilano Auditorium.
I'd like the leader to come to the mic.
What?
Come here, Bobby. Leader there. Leader man.
Arnold Emery.
Arnold. Well, I guess you know it's a pleasure because else I wouldn't be back this year. I come back last year this year. So you see, we have the very fine enjoyment out of everything. Now, I want you to announce to the public just what you're going to play the next number, and we're going to chime in with you.
Take
the mic, baby.
I figured might as well play Take the Ink, baby, because we played it last year and it went over pretty good, so I guess it'll go over last year, it'll go over this year.
Let's go back and say what year that was.
Well, it doesn't bother me. I mean, my mom used to say to me, she says, your health is your age. Isn't that the truth?
Exactly. You started out while you were still in high school.
Yeah.
At CJOR.
Right.
How old were you?
At CJOR, 1953, I would have been 16.
16 years old. And how did you manage to get your foot in the door there? There's an interesting story.
I was a big fan of radio as a kid. And there were two guys that really impressed me. One of them was Jack Cullen here in Vancouver, who had a night show called The Owl Prowl. And unlike, Mike, the announcers that I listened to, who were perfect diction and, you know, ladies and gentlemen, Cullen was, hey, you know what, I'd like to find the temperature out, and he'd take his microphone up on the roof of the place. And it was, in a sense, even with disc jockeys, theater of the mind. Then Sandy and those guys, I remember that. And there was an afternoon show called King's Open House, and this guy called Gil Henry. And what he did, like the old make-believe ballroom, he created an atmosphere where when he brought the singer on, you thought the singer was in the studio with him. And he had IDs from them too. And Jack Cullen, I thought, man, if I could just do this, it would be a dream come true. And they were my inspiration. So anyway, one day, they give the answer, the short form. Do that? So at one point there, I was on the air 55 hours a week. And
well, that takes us to the CKWX period. Now, you met some pretty famous people while you were working there at W.
Bill Haley and the Comets was the first rock and roll concert ever in this city. I was at CJOR at that time. But Jack Cullen and a clothier called Murray Goldman put the money up to put Bill Haley and the Comets on at the Carisdale Arena. Oddly enough, one of the kids in the audience was Bruce Allen. He told me that years later and said, oh, yeah, you said, you emceed that show. I said, yeah. So later on, as acts came to town, they would ask me to go and emcee the show, simply, I think, because of the following of the rock and roll show.
Well, you were king of the year for the kids.
Yeah. I get once in my life have I ever gone out to seek anything. And you know what? That makes all of these things extra special.
And I think you can say, as I do, I've never worked a day in my life.
No.
It's all been fun.
Strong, along with a buddy of mine by the name of Bobby Hughes, Friday noon hour, what do we used to call them, prep or pep meeting, something like that. It was a noon hour session in the auditorium, and I remember driving Louis and his troupe out to the school. This is the Kitsilano High School Band with Louis Armstrong playing trumpet and doing the vocal. One of his hit tunes of that era, Give Me a Kiss to Build a Dream On. Listen, you're Kits High. Didn't they squeal? You think it was Sinatra coming on stage.
During the fall of 1950, the Kitsilano Student Entertainment Committee, chaired by grade 12 student Olga, Ollie Negriff, sponsored by longtime Kitsilano Music Department head Ivor Parfit, hatched a plan to ask Louis Armstrong, staying at a downtown Vancouver hotel with his wife Lucille, to do a free noon-hour show on stage at Kitsilano High Auditorium for students and staff. Ollie Negriff had seen in the Vancouver newspapers that Louis Armstrong and the All-Stars, with vocalist Velma Middleton, were in town playing the Palomar Supper Club that sat across from the barred door of the Hotel Vancouver from 1937 until 1952. Louis Armstrong and the All-Stars played the Palomar annually back in the day. Ollie Negriff needed to talk to Kitsilano High Principal H.B. Smith before she and two other grade 12s, Bette Sparrow and Jerry Millard, set out to ask Louis Armstrong to do a show on stage at Kitsilano High Auditorium. She told the principal what the committee wanted to ask Louis Armstrong. H.B. Smith put his full support behind their plan. If Louis Armstrong was game, he was game. Kitsilano High Principal H.B. Smith has been praised as a nice man and no doubt a Louis Armstrong fan. With Principal H.B. Smith's full support, the Kitsilano High Student Entertainment Committee set out, led by Ollie, with Bette and Jerry, together, now headed down on the bus to Louis Armstrong's hotel lobby to try to get him on the house phone. They got Armstrong's wife Lucille on the phone. Lucille Armstrong asked the students to come back in the next afternoon for tea. So Ollie, Bette, and Jerry, grade 12 students who will graduate in 1951, set out the next day to have tea in the Armstrong suite. A very gracious Mrs. Lucille Armstrong received the trio of Kit students in the afternoon as the students nervously jittered through their cups of tea. It wasn't long until, at about 3 p.m., Louis Armstrong himself came out into the sitting room, resplendent in his paisley robe. After exchanging greetings and introductions, Louis asked what he could do for Kitsilano High. Ollie explained that the Kitsilano High principal, H.B. Smith, supported the committee's plan to ask him to come and play a noon hour on stage with the Kitsilano High Jazz Band at Kitsilano High Auditorium for all the students and staff of Kits High. Louis Armstrong was properly impressed and agreed to do an impromptu show. He and Velma Middleton with the 1951 Kitsilano High Jazz Band.
you very much, kid. Thank you. We're going to alternate as we go along on different numbers. Right now, is Velma ready? We're going to put Sullivan on the piano and Coase on the drum. Velma Middleton's coming out and beat out.
You look happy about this.
Like that, yeah.
Why are you so happy, sir?
Catlett played the drums on that. She just barely hit that bass drum every now and then. And they had the big band.
I've never seen Satchmo so happy as he seems to be over these old records tonight.
One of my favorite numbers as far as bands are concerned.
You liked the band at this era, did you?
I liked the band that recorded this. Especially Big Sid. We used to be on the one-nighters. Just look back at that guy. This little kid reminds me of Big Sid so much. This little kid we have now, Kenny John Hill.
Yeah. Which side will you have, Louie?
Among myself and I don't look nowhere else.
Okay, folks, recorded in Los Angeles. Yeah. April the 17th, 42, Louis Armstrong, Among My Souvenirs.
Yes.
Nothing left for me of days that used to be. I live in memories among my souvenirs.
Is on regular records, is it? The Jack Armstrong Blues, is it?
That could be, That's for the Soldiers.
Yes, this is a copy from a V-disc. I think Louis did a lot of work, ladies and gentlemen, during the war years for the Soldiers.
Story behind this, a fella that came to my house and he saw this record. He just had come back from the war, discharged, and he said one day they was getting ready to go into battle, you know. And everybody's standing erect in the ship, and it's a little boat that comes into them, you know, I guess before they go in. And saying this cat was playing Jack Armstrong Blues. This little boat rocking and waving, and boy, we were wailing. And some cat said, Green, listen to your boy. He said, well, I'm ready to go now. Just look like that. Just give him all the spirit in the world, honestly.
Well, here it is then, December the 7th, 1944, and let's listen to what Louis Armstrong was talking about, huh? The Jack Armstrong Blues, and Louis Armstrong's on this one, Jack T. Garnett, a wonderful lineup.
The baptismal certificate written in Latin for Louis Daniel Armstrong in the register of the Church of Sacred Heart of Jesus Christ, dated August 4th, 1901, has him as the son of William Armstrong and Mayanne Mary Albert. Louis Armstrong was born in James Alley between Perdido and Poydras Streets, known as Back of Town. On the night he was born, his mother, Mayanne, said that two guys had a shootout just outside their house, and they both killed each other. So Louis got a tough start already. As a child, he did errands and moved around the back of town. Eventually wanted to learn how to play music, did odd jobs to pay for his lessons. One day, when he was 12 years old, he got himself in trouble. Discharging a gun and a big celebration in New Orleans got him a little time in the Waifs home. Well, this was actually a good turn of events because Louis there was encouraged to practice playing the cornet and become part of the band. The discipline did him good, and he always went back to that old home and donated and thanked the people there for steering him into the right direction. Very tender age of 12 years old. Actually did odd jobs around the back of town, for King Oliver and his wife, who was inspired by Buddy Bolden, a man who was never recorded. Of course, King Oliver and Louis Armstrong were recorded from the 1920s, but Buddy Bolden is before that age, and if you ever heard Buddy Bolden, they say you would think it was Louis Armstrong. So Louis Armstrong goes in the spirit of Buddy Bolden, and of course progresses the horn much further over the decades after that. By 1917, the United States Navy is given the right to clear out the area also known as Storyville, which includes back of town, because the rounders and pimps and players of that district have gotten themselves into quite a lot of trouble due to the United States Navy now involved in World War I. The action just becomes too much. There's sailors killed and people inside Storyville killed in clubs, nightclubs, over different types of problems. So the Secretary of the United States Navy moves on cleaning up Storyville, District of New Orleans. This means that all kinds of people had to leave New Orleans after 1917. Most went due north and headed for the stockyards of Chicago, took their culture along with them, so hence Chicago inherits the blues and jazz because of the movement out of New Orleans. Some people went to the West Coast, went up through Los Angeles, San Francisco, Portland, Seattle, and ended up in Vancouver, British Columbia. So over the years, from 1917, there is an influence in our city in Vancouver in Canada from the original New Orleans jazz people who are moving out of there from 1917 on. King Oliver was now in Chicago and had sent messages to New Orleans to get up here, or we need you. So Louis went to the central station in New Orleans and got on a train from Chicago and took a cab from the station in Chicago right to the gig.
Hi there, and welcome to Dal's Place, where we take a nostalgic look at the sounds and times of the big bands and the unforgettable music of the 30s, 40s, 50s, and the 60s, all on your all-time favorite station, AM 650. How important was Louis Armstrong to jazz? It's kind of an ambiguous question. Well, no less an authority than the eminent music critic Will Friedlander asserted that in terms of the jazz vocal, Louis' style quickly blotted out the memory of everything that came before and set the standard for singers who came later. Louis started making jazz history in the roaring 20s as a cornet player with a group called the Hot Five. And 7 years after Louis' death in 1971, the editors of the Illustrated History of Jazz affirmed Louis as the greatest male jazz vocalist of all time. To the younger audience, that put his song What a Wonderful World on the top of the record charts in 1967. Louis may have been a trumpet player who could also sing, but to people who knew, Louis was the ultimate jazz vocalist. Tony Bennett put it this way: most people don't realize that Louis Armstrong set the standard for all singers about phrasing, how to relate one line to another to sell the lyric. Louis was a master. Ironically, Tony turned down an offer to record Wonderful World in 1968, so Louis somewhat reluctantly recorded it, and the song didn't become a huge hit until 20 years later when it was featured prominently in the hit movie Good Morning Vietnam.
I think to myself, what a wonderful.
Armstrong legend continues to this day with the Louis Armstrong Centennial Big Band playing weekly at the New York Jazz Club Birdland in New York. And our own Brius Gonford plays with the band.
Louis Armstrong created the coherent solo. Louis Armstrong fused the sound of the blues with the American popular song. Louis Armstrong extended the range of the trumpet. Louis Armstrong created the melodic and rhythmic vocabulary that all of the big bands wrote music out of.
went because my parents were Louis Armstrong fan, and around that time I became more interested in Louis Armstrong.
Logan Tate.
Logan, yeah.
Now, he says, so we're going to give you a picture of our school.
The president of our school has a few things to do and a few things to say to you. Logan Tate.
On behalf of our whole school, students, the teachers, everybody, it's really been terrific to have you and the fellows, everybody up. And we'd like to give a small token of appreciation, a picture of our school.
Oh.
Our last year's annual, which has your picture in it, it won the BC Championship for annuals, and we're glad to give it to you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, students, and I want you to know that when I get to be at home, I'll have this picture. And I have to say, I'm a real good son.
Cliff Zacharias was a grade 12 student in 1952 when Louis Armstrong played at Kitsilano for the second time. Observed that it was going to be a big task for the staff to get the students back to school into classes by 1 p.m. after the noon hour concert. Well, some old soldiers ran that school, including Principal H.B. Smith, who helped marshal over 1,000 excited Kitsilano students back to classes for the 1 p.m. start. So I take it that a solid soldier like Cliff Zacharias sized up the situation the way it was. Excitement, trying to contain themselves to get back to class. Cliff Zacharias graduated in the spring of 1952 from Kitsilano High School. While still only 18 years old in September 1952, he was already in the Royal Canadian Air Force, starting the RCAF's pilot training program back east in Ontario. Cliff served overseas flying the F-86 jets in Europe early in the Cold War. Canadian F-86s were the first NATO warplanes deployed in Europe using swept-wing jets, the mighty F-86. Cliff ably carried out many important flying missions all over the globe, including taking an RCAF C-130 Hercules into Saigon, Vietnam, to rescue orphans who were fleeing Vietnam in the middle of the big U.S. military pullout from Vietnam in 1975. Cliff finished his distinguished RCAF flying career with an assignment as chief briefer at the NORAD early warning system in the mountain at Colorado Springs. He briefed prime ministers and presidents alike on how that facility was monitoring the Soviet nuclear threat
until his retirement from the Canadian Air Force.
Well, I decided it was time to leave English Bay and head out to Fort Langley, British Columbia, to talk to a fellow who'd also grown up along the shores of Kitsilano, Doug Sturrock, who saw Louis Armstrong when he was in grade 10, making him a graduate of the 1954 class at Kitsilano High School. And he saw Louis Armstrong play on stage at Kitsilano in 1952, the show recorded by Jack Cullen. So I hopped the transit, took the Sky Train out to Surrey, and got on to the Surrey bus that took me to Fort Langley. And I kept thinking about the Hudson Bay Company. Now, my father worked for the Hudson Bay Company in the 50s, and the Hudson Bay Company is all over the Lower Mainland and all over Canada. And now I'm going out to the original Hudson Bay Fort in Fort Langley, where Doug Sturrock now lives. And he agreed that he'd pick me up at the Colossus Theater. Well, I'm thinking that must be a quaint little theater like we all grew up with at the Hollywood and the Hollywood Theater and the Ridge Theater, the Dunbar Theater, all those suburban theaters that we all grew up with. Thinking that's where I'm going to meet Doug, at a nice little theater. Well, I couldn't have been more wrong. But Doug did meet me and took me on a little tour of Fort Langley. But here's Doug as we got out to Fort Langley, and him having been a 35-year man as a teacher at McGee later in his career and a great rugby coach. But as a teacher, he explained to me that there were two locations of Fort Langley. Thank you, Doug. There it is, still there. It's some of the oldest buildings on the west coast of Canada that still remain. Then he drove me through the town of Fort Langley, showed me some of the sites there. And we got down to talking about being from Kitsilano originally, and how the where he lives now is easygoing.
He could, you know, hello, good morning. And even if you don't know them. And that goes on now. Except for they get tourists here, they're so busy on looking around, they don't bother to say hello. But the people who live here.
Easygoing, friendly.
Always.
Something like everybody. Your experience in Kitsilano.
Yes.
Along Broadway between good old MacDonald to Elma.
Broadway and MacDonald being kind of the center of the action for him and anybody who ever went to Kitsilano High. Doug and I had both worked at the McGavin's Bakery that was at Broadway and Arbutus near the tram line and so on. And of course, down to old West Broadway.
When I was there, like I knew like the shoemaker's name. Okay, I knew the grocer, the meat fellow. I knew some of the people in the Safeway. And the Safeway at that time was at Broadway and Bayswater. Pharmacist across the street. My mom and her mother used to have tea at Broadway and Mackenzie.
In the early 1990s, we approached teacher librarian Giovanna Bombino at her post at Kitsilano High Library. She was early in her career as a teacher librarian, but already wise. I asked Giovanna if the Kitsilano High Library held any information about the very vague story told to me of Louis Armstrong having played on stage at Kitsilano High Auditorium, and if I could take a little look at it and do some research on the topic at Kitsilano High. I had an inkling of a memory of my high school band and drama days in the mid-1960s, until 1969. On stage at Kitsilano High Auditorium, I had spotted Louis Armstrong autographed on the wall in the day in the wings of the Kitsilano High Auditorium. I asked somebody, I don't remember who, likely a fellow band student or drama type, hey, what's this, a Louis Armstrong autograph? And that somebody said something about Louis Armstrong having played at Kitsilano High. There was no year attached to it, and no more details about the autograph written in dark pen on a light-colored wall, as I recall. So for another 30 years, I didn't think about it or hear anything about it at all. A very responsible teacher-librarian, Giovanna Bombino, had started her career at Kitsilano High decades after Louis Armstrong played Kitsilano High. And when she found documentary evidence of that fact in the high school archives that were threatened by neglect and possible destruction at that time, she acted and organized the Louis Armstrong collection at the Kitsilano High Archives. The core of the small collection has audio tape recordings on cassette of the second show Louis Armstrong and company did at Kitsilano. I learned from the collection that Louis Armstrong played an impromptu show on stage in the auditorium on Wednesday, March 14th, 1951. We have interviews done by Jack Cullen on his radio show, The Owl Prowl. And he talks with Louis about Louis's career and plays back some of the material that Louis Armstrong did at Kitsilano High in 1952.
We will now be playing Taking a Trip. The Kitsilano